And now I'm going to give you another one.
Right, listen to what he says. These verses are given as a general statement. Hear that? As a general statement, and the order to fight the people of the earlier revelations until they pay the jizya, until they pay the submission tax with a willing hand and are subject and are subdued is also of general import. In other words, all of the great Muslim scholars that you now want to chuck under the bus are all telling you you're wrong. They're all telling you that this is a general teaching that calls you to fight the Christian because the Christian is not a Muslim. Right? Now, the point is, you are entitled to chuck them under the bus. And if you're willing to say that they are all wrong, then I will engage with your argument. But unless you're willing to say on camera that Samak Shari was wrong, that Ibn Kathir was wrong, that Musayyabi was wrong, that Suyuti was wrong, that Ibn Kathir was wrong, that Qubti was wrong, unless you are willing to say that they are all wrong, then I think I'm on good grounds by believing their tasmiyah over your tasmiyah.
I'm not saying they're wrong.
Thank you.
I'm not saying they're wrong. I'm saying you've gone to one verse again. It's the one verse thing. You can bring up the tasfiyah of 9:13 then. Bring up the tasfiyah of all of those, you know, all of those interpreters on 9:13. Bring that up. That suggests bring up tasfiyah on the entire.
You're the one making the argument.
Well, no, you've boasted about your amazing lists of many Muslim theologians right?
Who have quoted 9:29 and given their understanding.
Amazing,
of it.
And I want them for 9:13 as well.
But
I
want to agree with them.
Because I'm saying you should go to 9:30.
So let's be clear, you're saying you don't agree with Qubti, who says that this is a command of general import.
I'm saying if you go to one verse.
Well practiced by the Dawah Dynasty.
Freedom of religion.
Okay, never mind. You can't then make that as like a complete instruction to every Muslim everywhere. It can't be that. Because if that was the case, what would the same theologian have to say about the earlier verses? Clearly don't suggest that.
Right, so that one. In reply to your comment, I have never said that every single Muslim should do this at every point in their life.
I'm not saying you say you should do it, but you're saying you suggest
it. What I want to point out now is your duplicitousness.
I know, right?
I want to ask you very clearly, right? Qubti, in his tasfiyah of 9:29, says this: these verses are given as a general statement, and the order to fight the people of earlier revelations until they pay the submission tax with a willing hand and are subdued is also of general import.
Yep.
Do you agree or disagree with that statement?
Agree, and because if you look at the...
You agree.
Look at this. No,
Look at the statement.
Earlier revelation. What's the earlier revelation? 9:13. Clearly.
No. The earlier revelation, the people of the earlier revelation, listen carefully.
Where does it say that?
Says by the people of the earlier revelation.
The people
who's
of the earlier revelation.
Who's the
you
people?
You said.
The Alim al-Kitab.
You said the earlier revelation. You said from
9:13. I'll hold my breath.
Sure. You on in the verse 9:13. You said it was the Jews who broke their oath.
Yes.
Yeah. How is that not the people of the earlier revelation?
You're not listening to Qubti, are you? Qubti says, and you've already admitted that you agree with it. So you kind of expose yourself. Listen, Dawood. Listen, it says is of general import. Do you know what that means? Of general import. What does that mean? Yeah, when something is of general import. Yeah, it's a general instruction manual that's applicable to all applicable on a continuous basis, isn't it? Thank you. So, Qubti, who you agree with, says that this passage about fighting the people of earlier scriptures is a general instruction to Muslims today.
But clearly, your magnifying glass and zoom it in on what Kupke put on this, right? And if you ignore what Kupke may have
you
said...
You put a quote for 913 from Kupke because that's your argument. It's not my job to help you. You do.
Like the expert rule was like... You know,
why are you frightened to pull up his task here? Pull up his task here, see what it says. Why not?
Why don't you just pull up task sphere off line?
Let's see if we can do it. Let's see. I'm gonna prove you wrong
that you can do it in 3 minutes. Maybe not 3 minutes.
We're gonna pull up the task sphere for 9:30, and let's see if people and
bearing in mind you're sunk now,
right? Because you've agreed with Let me ask you this question. Let me ask you: do you agree with Saadi who says the point of this fighting is so non-Muslims then turn over their wealth that is given in return for Muslims not fighting them and allowing them to stay amongst the Muslims, granting them safety for their lives and property? Do you agree with Al-Saadi that that is what the verse is? So you disagree with Al-Saadi?
What was the mention of like money?
You disagree with Al-Saadi?
On this book.
It says it money. The money is the reference. Where's the money in 929? It's reference to the jizya. What's the jizya? What's the tax connected to? Money.
The government.
So it's connected to money. So here you go. So it is connected to money. Yeah? The problem is, Dawood, is that you want to make Islam into something that it's not. And I think that is unfortunate. Because I think that you're better than your book. You don't want to fight unbelievers because they're just Christians and Jews, and you're a better person than your book allows you to be. And that's a good thing. But now it's unfortunate that Yassin checked out of this debate.
I actually didn't come here to discuss this. I watched one of your earlier videos about slavery, right?
Right.
And I was itching to respond. You claim that Muslims...
So you want to close down this conversation? Hold on one second. I'm not saying I agree to close down this conversation. I'm just want to check if you want to close down this conversation.
Because I came in with something else.
Yeah? Yeah, you burst into this conversation that he was having. So I want to point out, in Sahih al-Muslim, Muhammad says, and I want to ask you if you agree with this or not, right?
If I answer this point, can we move on?
Yeah. Well, I'll have a final comment, but then Sahih Muslim, it says this, Muhammad speaking. I have been commanded to fight against the people until they testify that there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, and they establish prayer and pay zakat, and if they do it, their blood and property are guaranteed protection on my behalf, except when justified by law, and their affairs rest with Allah. Is Muhammad an example to you in that statement? In Sahih al-Muslim, Hadith 36 and Hadith 33. I'll read it again. This is Muhammad. He is saying, I have been commanded to fight against the people until they testify that there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, and they establish prayer and pay zakat, and if they do it, their blood and property are guaranteed protection on my behalf, except when justified by law, and their affairs rest with Allah. My question to you again is Muhammad an example to you in that statement?
If I was living in 7th century Arabia.
So you're saying that he's not an example for you today?
Yeah, because I'm not going to.
Great, you're better than Muhammad.
Okay, moving on. Because I want
that protection of rights. Is he talking about protection of rights?
You let him burst in. So no, the Muhammad is saying, you burst into his conversation. Yeah. He can burst back in.
You want me? Right. I can go.
Yeah. Dawood. 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 Yassin. Yeah. Well, you called him Dawood, not me. So
yeah, exactly.
Yassin. Yassin. Yeah. Right. I've demonstrated that your book legitimizes religious persecution. Will you now condemn it?
Not really.
And why not, Yassin? Because you stopped talking and you walked off.
Yeah, because
no. What? Sorry.
I was talking to people that were supporting.
No, because you entered into a conversation. You asked me to prove something, and then when I was demonstrating the proof, you walked away.
I'm sorry for the demonstration.
Thank you. So let's do it again. So, in
verse 29,
9:29.
Right. Showed you verse 13.
Yeah, we've gone through that. You should have been here. So now my question is this: if the British government was to impose upon the Muslims a differentiated tax on account of them being Muslims that could be higher than taxes given to Christians, would you call that a discriminatory tax?
That's the only condition. That's because we're different.
And if you don't pay it, we're going to take your children, we're going to take your wives, we're going to take your property. Okay, so are you...
Show me that, take the children, wives, property, show me.
So what is the jizya tax?
A jizya tax, regardless of what it is, you only pay it as a Christian or Jew, then you don't have to fight for the country. You don't have to do this, you don't have to do that. The other rights that everyone has to be abiding by, you don't do.
And what happens if you don't pay it?
Right now, who even pays jizya tax?
What happens if you don't pay it?
I don't know.
Yeah, good.
It doesn't even talk about it.
Because the world has become a better place because we have abolished the jizya tax. And the world is better without it.
I don't know.
The world is a better place without the jizya tax. Do you know what the Pact of Umar is? Yeah, the Pact of Umar. Yeah? The Pact of Umar. It is an early forgery within Islam that was accredited to when Umar took over Christian lands.
What did he forge?
Well, it's we don't know who forged it. I think most hadiths are forged. But in the Pact of Umar, it restricts the restoration of places of worship. It says that Christians can't ride on saddles. It says that Christians couldn't have hanging swords on their shoulders.
So where do I search up the...
Yeah, you go and look up the Pact of Umar. Yeah, the Pact of Umar. Now, also, while you're doing it, it'd be much more helpful for you to look at what the jizya tax is. Because the jizya tax is clearly referenced in the Quran. The jizya tax is protection money. If we don't pay the jizya tax, our lives, our property, and then the lives of our children and wives become forfeit. Did you know that? Well, I'm educating you about your deen now. Yeah, please do. I'll wait for you to confirm.
The Pact of Umar is a treaty that established the rights and obligations of non-Muslims.
Correct.
Why would you want to even have rights and obligations for non-Muslims if you're going to subjugate them anyway?
Because you can subjugate people through rights, even Jews in the Third Reich.
Why would you? You have the sword and you have control over the lands. Why even give them rights?
Because different people practice injustice in different ways. Let me give you an example. Hitler, when he oppressed the Jews,
he
did give them rights.
Like what?
Yes, they could live in the ghetto. They were allowed to trade a certain amount.
They were allowed to do certain kinds of work.
They were allowed to marry one another. So the point is, they were allowed rights.
And then you took them away and sent them to the camp.
Yes, indeed.
Well, Islam never did that, so it's a bad example.
No, it's a...
It's not similar.
No. Yassin, I'm sorry you can't follow an argument, but let's be clear. The Pact of Umar does this. It restricts the rights of Christians and turns them into second-class citizens.
That's what it says here.
Let's go into it. This is the kind of things that it says. It says that Christians can't restore places.
It's a response as a request for protection of Christians. Protection.
Yeah, that's the preamble given commentary.
This is AI.
What are the rights? What are the actual rights? What restrictions does the Pact of Umar... Because I can Google it as well.
So head tax in exchange for protection and exemption
from
military...
What does it say about the repairing of churches?
You said all laws, right?
Oh my gosh. Rules.
A head tax, that's the jizya tax you were talking about.
Thank you.
For Jews and Christians...
Correct.
In exchange for...
Yes.
Protection and exemption from military service. So
protection from who?
From other countries.
No.
Other wars,
protection
other
from the Ummah. Protection from Muslims. Look, I'm going to give you one more chance to read honestly what he's saying in the Pact of Umar, or I'll just get it myself. Yassin, listen.
You support his argument?
Yassin.
You want to read it?
Yassin. How about I read it?
Okay, read it.
Right.
Read it.
Listen. Let's look into it.
One by one.
One second. Let's. May I?
Not that good.
May I? Okay. Is this AI? Right. Here's the thing. The Pact of Umar says, and this is why he didn't win a reed, the prohibition of Jews and Christians from holding government office.
Okay.
Now let me ask you this question. If we pass
Can
the law...
Can a Muslim become Prime Minister?
Yes.
No.
Yes. No. Yes. Let me ask you this question. Yassin.
No.
Yassin, yes you can.
Muslim Arab.
Yes,
Muslim
Arab. Yassin.
Can a Muslim Arab become a British Prime Minister?
Yes. What's his name again?
No, I'll show you.
Wait. Sorry, it's your phone, sorry.
Yeah, no.
Right? So here's the point. Yassin doesn't understand the country his parents migrated to. Because unlike me, in a Muslim country, Yassin can become the Prime Minister of this country. But no Christian migrant to Saudi Arabia could ever become the ruler of Saudi Arabia. And the proof is in Humza Yousaf, who became the first minister of Scotland, who was a Muslim. We've had Muslim ministers of the Exchequer, Muslim foreign secretaries.
No. Arabic.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, in the Pact of Umar that Yassin got, it says that Christians and Jews can't join the government. If we passed a law that said Muslims cannot join government, would you say that that was Islamophobic? Yes. So in other words, if we do it to the Muslims, it's bad. But if they do it to us, it's okay. Do you condemn the Pact of Umar?
I'm still reading. I can condemn it in 5 minutes.
Can you condemn that law of the Pact of Umar that says the one that says prohibition on Jews and Christians holding government office? Do you condemn it? You can't condemn it. But you said if I could prove to you religious intolerance.
You're talking about now or back then?
1 second.
Because Islamophobia now is different to Jewophobia, whatever.
Christophobia.
Right?
Is Sharia law applicable all the time?
Yes, it's applicable all the time.
So does that law apply today?
This isn't Sharia law.
Can a Christian become a caliph?
Is the Pact of Umar the Sharia law?
Can a Christian become a caliph? Yes, that was their interpretation. That was their fiqh.
No.
That was fiqh.
No, that's not their interpretation.
Do you know what fiqh is?
No, I don't know.
I'm having to teach you a lot about your deen here. So, right? Fiqh is the legal, it is the opinion about how you apply Sharia law. The Pact of Umar is fiqh. And it's practiced by the madhabs. Type in, can Christians rule over Muslims? In Hanafi. Or Hanbali. What's the others? I forget. Maliki or Shafi. Ask, can Christians rule over Muslims? In which madhab says that they can do that?
It's the prohibition of Jews and Christians from holding government office.
Correct. And you said if we did that to Muslims, that's Islamophobic.
Now?
Yeah.
But back then it's different.
So can Muslims hold office, or can Christians hold office over Muslims today under Sharia law?
I'm not sure.
No, they can't. Sharia law prohibits Christians from ruling over Muslims. That's the fiqh of all the madhabs.
What do you mean rule over? Is this a Christian country?
No, not really.
Is Ireland a Christian country?
Nope.
Can you name one Christian country?
The Vatican.
Another Christian country.
The Vatican would be a Christian
Poland.
Country.
If I went to live in Poland, I fucked up.
Right, he's checking. Don't let him check out of this conversation.
Check out.
There is.
I'm saying, as a Muslim right now, if I go live in Poland, you said Christians can't rule over you, right?
Right. I believe in.
What does that mean?
Well, let me give you an example. I believe that in a Christian government, Muslims can achieve high office, so long as they implement laws according to Christian principles.
Exactly.
But Christians, that is not true in Islam.
Yes.
Muslims Christian. Can't. Now notice, he's just, before he didn't know, he had to check. But all of a sudden he's stealing my answer to try and make Islam look okay.
What do you mean stealing my answer?
Literally, you're about,
you
you're about to
I'm
steal
using your
my...
Logic against you.
No.
Muslims can't live under Christian rule. if I want to live in Poland, am I an effed up Muslim? Well, all the Muslims live in Poland.
Correct.
What does that mean for your argument?
Right, here's what it means.
And this is without understanding, so imagine I knew as well. Imagine the other people
you'd actually know
what the religion is.
You'd be arguing different if you understood. But the point is, Yassin, you're trying to just...
Also, this is not religious subjugation.
It is religious subjugation.
I'm hearing people are allowed to live. When the
but they can't enter.
We're killing them.
Yassin.
There was a negotiation.
Yassin, listen.
So what does that mean?
Yassin, these are sound bites, not arguments. Firstly, the Muslims under Christian rule live better than under Muslims. Sorry, the Muslims under Christian rule live better under Christian rule than Muslims lived under Muslim rule.
I don't think so.
Yes, they did, ladies and gentlemen. Furthermore, you said it was Islamophobic if we barred Muslims from government. But you won't condemn the Pact of Umar that says that Christians should be barred from high government. I've demonstrated that Islam teaches religious discrimination. Now, all you have to do is condemn the Pact of Umar. Just condemn that rule.
The rule, not the pact.
Yeah, well, yeah, if you condemn that one rule, you're condemning the pact. You're saying it's flawed. Will you condemn that rule? Will you condemn that rule?
Which rule then?
The one that says Christians and Christians can't be government. Will you condemn that rule?
But it's not even true.
What's not true?
I'll tell you why it's not true.
Right, go on.
Who knows about the story where it was the main physician of the Sultan back in the day, I think in the Ottoman Empire, was a Jew. He's a physician.
He's not in government.
Oh, so it's only a government job.
Well, physicians are not government, bro. No one thinks like that. No one thinks your local GP is in the government.
So if I find any Jew or Christian in governments back then, that answers everything?
No, I'll give you an example. During the occupation of Spain, the caliph of the Caliphate of Cordoba allowed Jews to rule over the Muslims.
Oh.
And you know what it resulted in? An anti-Semitic riot that led to the death of 5,000 Jews and the toppling of that government. That's what it led to. So let's see.
The Pact of Umar doesn't apply today. But you see, I've condemned it.
For example, common before the modern period for non-Muslims to serve an Islamic government, despite the supposed prohibition. Why is it? What does that mean?
Because when the Muslims invaded Christian land,
why were some allowed to be in the government?
I'm going to explain.
Yeah,
I'll give you an example.
Give me an example.
John of Damascus. And the reason why was because when Muslims invaded Christian land, they invaded lands that already had an administrative structure on top. And the Arabs didn't have the education to do the kind of projects that they wanted to do. And so when they wanted to build a fleet to besiege Constantinople, they didn't have the wit or the education to do that. So John of Damascus was the administrative functionary that managed the building of the fleet, because the Arabs had just come out of the desert and they didn't know the first thing about building fleets. But as Muslims came to dominate, they increasingly pushed Christians out of government. The fact that not Muslims don't practice Islam properly doesn't mean
that Islam is incorrect.
Yeah, exactly. But it doesn't mean it's true either.
Yeah, sure.
Right.
That was my main point. Muslims do a lot of bad.
Can you show me any Islamic fiqh that says that a Christian can rule over a Muslim?
I'm saying if every Muslim believed it, then Islam was messed up. Why were some Christians and Jews in positions of government?
Okay.
And in positions of power.
Yassin, let's come back to the issue that you're running from. What's the jizya tax? Goodbye, Yassin. Take care.
Friend?
Yassin. Before I'll come back. Yassin, do you have a Bible, bro?
No, Muslim.
That's okay. I don't believe in the Quran, but I got a Quran.
I don't have a Bible.
You have a Bible at home?
I don't read the Bible. I prefer this Bible.
Good Bible.
I only have King James.
Yeah, well, that's, if you've got a Bible, brilliant. Have a read of it, come back and ask a question.
Why have you got a book you don't read? I have a question.
Oh, you do? No,
I'll finish it. Is it true that the oldest Bible?
Well, obviously the Bible comes in two testaments. So the Bible comes in two testaments, Old Testament and New Testament. The Old Testament, our oldest manuscripts of the Old Testament come from the first century. They're in the Dead Sea Scrolls, so they're contemporaneous to the life of Jesus.
Wait, first century?
Yeah, the contemporaneous.
The Old Testament.
Yes.
The one that was supposed to be revealed to Moses.
The Old Testament doesn't just refer to the books that were revealed to Moses. It also includes the Psalms of David, which you call the Zabur. It also includes
David
the prophets like Isaiah, who you believe in.
But they all lived much before the first century.
Correct. But you asked me about the oldest manuscript.
Right.
I'm answering that question.
But for the New Testament.
When
is the oldest one?
Let me ask you this question, Yassin.
Answer the question.
I have answered your question.
The New Testament, when is the oldest manuscript that we have?
Are you wanting a fragment or something complete?
Either.
So the oldest...
What's the oldest fragment?
So the oldest fragment... The oldest fragment... You can see it in Manchester, you can go and see it yourself. The oldest fragment dates to around 125 AD.
125 AD?
Correct.
125 AD.
Now let me ask you a question, because this isn't a one-way street. What is your oldest copy of the Quran? When is it dated to?
Around 20 years after Prophet Muhammad.
That's a lie. Your oldest complete Quran, according to Islamic tradition, is the Tahkafi and the... What's the other one? I think it is actually the Tahkafi. But the people that date the Quran date it to the 8th century. Now, can you explain to me, Yassin?
568 to 645.
No, these are portfolios. The Birmingham portfolios, the manuscripts that were found in Birmingham, are not complete Qurans. I asked you about complete Qurans.
But nothing is dated to the time of Jesus.
Do you know why?
Jesus is Aramaic, I heard.
Yassin, you know, just repeating sound bites doesn't help you learn.
What sound bites?
Right? You asked me a question about why is there nothing dated to the time of Jesus?
Yeah.
Are you listening? Yassin.
You have to answer my question.
I'm trying to, but you keep interrupting every time I try to answer your question.
Can you answer my question?
I'm trying to, but you keep interrupting every time I try to answer your question. So the reason why is that back 2,000 years ago, at the time of Jesus, people wrote on what was called papyrus. Papyrus is an organic material. It's not like paper. I know paper is organic. It's essentially leaves. They essentially wrote on leaves. Leaves, by their nature, just rot over time.
So it's lost.
Yeah, it's lost. But that doesn't mean it wasn't copied. Are you aware of that?
What do you mean it wasn't?
Well, obviously, a person copies a book. Can you show me a full Quran from the 7th century? No, you can't.
That was my question.
I'm asking your question. Can you show me a full Quran from the 7th century?
You're a Christian preaching Christianity, and a Muslim coming to learn you.
No. You're interrupting every question. So you're not here to learn, you're here to...
You answered the question.
Yes.
Okay, so that question you answered, can I follow?
Yeah, but yeah, when you answer my question, I'm asking your question. Because I'm asking
you. I'm not even that informed, you're informed.
Yeah, great, so let me educate you.
Okay, educate.
Right, so you can't find a full copy of the Quran from the 7th century. Now please explain to me how, when the Muslims had an entire empire and all the resources of an empire at their disposal, that we can't, and the people were writing on paper in the 7th century, that with all that, you can't find a full and complete Quran from the 7th century. Your earliest Quran comes from a century later. Why? What's going on? Please answer that question.
It says the fragments found in the Birmingham manuscript.
I said complete copy, not fragments.
But these fragments, they're in line with what we have today.
No, the carbon dating is earlier than Muhammad.
The one you talked about, Oldest Bible, 125 AD, which isn't full, I just searched it.
Yeah, it's a fragment.
Yeah. That fragment, it says some verses are left out. Is that true?
No, that fragment doesn't say that at all. No,
not the fragment. Google says that modern scholars don't agree that some verses weren't left out.
Right, you're confusing two different things there.
So explain it.
Right. So, firstly, you've got an issue in Islam. You have no complete Quran from the 7th century.
Right.
Despite the fact that you had the power of an empire and people were writing on paper.
Now
let me explain why that's a problem. Now let me explain why that's a problem. Because when Christianity converted the Roman Empire in the 4th century, and suddenly we found ourselves with the power of an empire, what emerges? The first complete copies of the Bible. You can see them today. You can go to the British Library and you can go and see the Codex Vaticanus and the Codex Sinaiticus. They are earlier than Islam. The moment the Christians had the power of an empire, we suddenly see full Bibles appearing. But yet Muslims are telling us they had the power of an empire, but yet they haven't managed to preserve a single Quran from the 7th century when we managed to preserve a Bible from the 4th century when we had the power of an empire. Why? What's going on?
Islam didn't start out with the great empire ruled at the time, right? Muhammad didn't start out with the great empire.
When did the Muslim empire start?
Is that true or not?
When did it start?
Is it true or not?
Muhammad did have an empire, yes, in Arabia. Yes, he did. Did he conquer Arabia?
No, he didn't actually. Muhammad himself didn't conquer.
Yes, he conquered Mecca.
Yes, but Mecca isn't Mecca. Arabia. And anyway,
the tribes in the north of Mecca were paying zakat to Muhammad.
It's not Arabia. A few cities here and there that all had tents.
That was pretty much the population of America. That's an empire, bro. If you rule more than one place as a ruler, that's an empire. It's a small empire, but it's an empire.
And 400 years after Jesus died, that's a lot of years.
Yes, and you haven't thought this through.
You said 400 years, right?
When did Muslims invade Christian land?
You say 400 years or not?
When did Muslims invade Christian land?
Why can you never answer my question?
In the 7th century.
I don't know. 400 years after Jesus died is your oldest manuscript.
No, that is not true. Listen.
When is the oldest manuscript?
Right.
New Testament.
We've got to be clear about that.
That's why I'm making it clear.
Right, yes, we're going to.
So when is it?
So let me educate you about the terms. Manuscript can refer to fragments or complete copies.
No, I said full. You said, let's be clear. I'm saying
and
full.
I have answered that question.
So 400 years?
It is 4 centuries. When Christians had an empire.
Let's say both of them
had. But Muslims had an empire in the 7th century, and you can't provide a Quran from the 7th century.
So they
why not?
And stupid
why did the Quran...
One is 100 years late.
Okay. Exactly. Why is that? Why is that?
I don't know why it is. One is 100 years late, one is 400 years late.
Shall I tell you why? Because Muslims changed their Quran and they destroyed the evidence.
There's errors in the Bible. There's contradictions in the Quran.
Are you aware that there are contradictions in the Quran? Do you want me to show you one? All right, let me show you a contradiction.
Well, you're showing me. What about the contradiction in the Bible? How do Christians usually explain that?
Well, it depends on the contradiction.
Age contradiction.
It depends on the contradiction.
So you're saying every contradiction has an explanation?
Every contradiction I've encountered has an explanation.
But what about the fact that there's
so now you wanted me to show you a contradiction. So let me show you a contradiction. Okay? So in Surah 7, 109. Surah 7, 109. Do you want to read it or shall I? Okay. So I'll read it. Surah 7, 109, it says this. Said the chiefs of the people of Pharaoh, this is indeed a sorcerer well-versed. So who's speaking to whom? I'll read it in context so you can pick up the context. Okay.
Pharaoh said, this is, I'm reading from 106, Pharaoh said, if indeed thou hast come with a sign, show it forth, if thou tell us the truth. Then Moses threw his rod, and behold, it was a serpent plain for all to see. And he drew out his hand, and behold, it was white to all the beholders. Said the chiefs of the people of Pharaoh, this is indeed a sorcerer well versed. His plan is to get you out of your land. Then what is it ye counsel? So who's speaking to whom? You've got to pay attention. Not a good listening, Yassin. Look, it literally says it. Said the chiefs of the people. Well, he's speaking to Pharaoh because Pharaoh is the one.
Said the chiefs of the people.
Look. 109. We'll do this slowly. Surah 7, verse 109.
The elders of Pharaoh's people said, surely this man is a skillful magician.
So who's speaking to
him? You out of your land.
Who's speaking to who?
The elders of the Pharaoh's people. But I don't know who they're speaking to.
Right. Well, who do you think they're speaking to?
Pharaoh?
Where was yeah, exactly, because Moses is in Pharaoh's court. Right, and Pharaoh is the ruler. So when you're going to address, you're not going to address the common man, the servant. You're going to address who? You're going to address the ruler, aren't you?
Okay.
So they're addressing Pharaoh.
Nice.
Am I being fair?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. So, that's Surah 7, 109. Let's go to Surah 26, 33. Surah 26.
Court of Moses and his brother for the wine, and send forth heralds to the cities to send them every skillful magician to your brother.
Sorry, Surah 6, verse 34. It says, Pharaoh said to the chiefs around him, this is indeed a sorcerer well versed. His plan is to get you out of your land by his sorcery. Then what is it he counseled? So who said what to who? Right. So in one verse, it said that I said to you. In the other verse, it said that you said to me.
Didn't say I.
I'm using
the read the same verse.
Oh, my brother. Oh, you really
mean? You said I said to you. No, it doesn't.
Pay attention.
Okay.
In one verse, it said that Pharaoh said to the chief priests, which you can logically think of as person A says to person B. In the other verse, it says that the chiefs said to Pharaoh, which is the equivalent of saying person B says to person A. That's a contradiction. It's either person A or person B. Who is it? Did you get it? Did you understand it? Did you understand it? Who else was listening? Did you understand it? Did you understand?
Have you explained it to me right now?
Yassin, how is it that everyone around us understands it except
we're
you?
We're going to test. Everyone's recording. You explain.
He's pretty much saying one instance Pharaoh is speaking, but in another instance it's another person speaking.
To Pharaoh.
To Pharaoh.
Yeah, show me that.
So it's either Pharaoh speaking or someone speaking to Pharaoh. Which one is it?
Right. Shall we do this again?
Surah 6:34. Messengers before you have been giving the lie to, and they endured with patience. They've been giving the lie to.
No, Surah 26.
This is Surah 26.
26. Yassin, bro, you've got to listen. Less pride, less arrogance, more humility leads to more learning. Right? If you weren't so arrogant and so proudful that you're the better man because you're the Muslim. Right? I know exactly. And look what it's done to you. Your pride has made stopped up to your ears. You can't listen.
I heard 6 instead of 26.
Everybody else heard what I had to say. Right, listen. Surah 26, Ayah 34. Pharaoh said to the chiefs around him, this is indeed a sorcerer well versed. His plan is to get you out of your land by his sorcery. What then is it ye counsel? Who's speaking according to that passage?
The Pharaoh to the chiefs.
The Pharaoh to the chiefs. Now let's go to Surah 7. Verse 1, verse... it does help if I actually go to Surah 7. Bear with us. Sorry, I was back in Surah 9. Verse 109. Surah 7, verse 109. Said the chiefs of the people of Pharaoh, this is indeed a sorcerer well versed. His plan is to get you out of the land. Then what is it ye counsel?
So who said what?
And then it said they advised Pharaoh put off Moses and his brother for a while and send forth heralds to your cities and summon every skillful magician to your presence.
So who said
and
what?
And the magicians
then?
Came to Pharaoh and said, shall we have a reward if
right,
we win?
So who said what? Now answer the question, who said what?
What would you have us do?
Who said these words? This is indeed a sorcerer well versed. Was it the chiefs to Pharaoh or was it the Pharaoh to the chiefs? Who said those words?
The Pharaoh's people said, surely this man is a skillful magician. So you're saying that because the Pharaoh said it and the elder said it, that's a contradiction.
Right. It is a contradiction. It is a contradiction.
Why?
And here's why. Listen carefully to the words. Right? This is why, and this is where you've just got to think a bit deeper. If you're less arrogant and less proudful, you can learn more. Just think about the logical contradiction of this. That in Surah 9, said the chiefs of the people of Pharaoh, this is indeed a sorcerer. His plan is to get you out of your land. Then what is your counsel? They said. Right? They said.
So it says now, is indeed a skilled magician.
Yes.
It's a combo.
Right.
It's
so
a conversation.
Correct. But listen.
It's all contradiction.
If it's they said.
I have said, in the Bible that say he's 22 and he's 20 and he's 42.
Listen.
There's hundreds of.
So you're saying they just said the same thing to one another at the same time.
No. Does it say they said that at the same time? It does.
Your logic is that.
But is that? Show me another.
No. This is fine. This one works. This one works. No, I've got
this
more.
One works.
I've got more. This one works. I've got more. This one works. Right? So it's the same point in the story.
I'm not be arrogant and learn. I'm asking for another example.
No.
You only
this
have
one's
one?
Fine. Okay. We'll say you haven't got. We have others. But we'll just park it. We'll just park it that Yassin doesn't have an answer to it.
No, we're not. We'll park it means we can move on to another a contradiction.
So let me show you another contradiction. Let me show you another contradiction. Right?
This one is...
Okay. Do you need to go?
Soon, yeah. Would you rather have something like 5 minutes?
Okay. One more. All right. Here's a contradiction.
It's in the Bibles. I can have 100 such stuff right now.
Listen. Yes, and we can find lots of contradictions in the Quran. Here's one. In Surah 28, 88, it says, everything perishes but Allah's face. So what happens to Allah's shin? Surah 28, 88. Right? Surah 28, 88.
Everything perishes except Allah's face.
Yeah.
And do not invoke any other god with Allah. There is no god worthy of worship except Him. Everything is bound to perish except He Himself. All authority belongs to Him, and to Him you will all be
right. In the Arabic, it doesn't say He Himself. In the Arabic, it says His face.
And His face only?
His face. Everything perishes face. Except His face.
Okay.
That's what it says.
Let him read Arabic, though.
I don't think this guy can read the Arabic, bro.
Okay.
There's a difference between reciting Arabic and I can read Latin. That doesn't mean I can translate it.
Memorization.
So everything perishes except his face.
So all these official translations are wrong. So when we get contradictions in the Bible,
what do you
want to get it from translation?
Are you trying to run away? Yesy. You talked about, you wanted to see another contradiction in the Quran. So let's talk about a contradiction in the Quran. Yeah? In Surah, is it, have I got the right place?
The contradictions we find in the Bible.
You're trying to run away from the contradiction in the Quran, Yassin. Doesn't help you. It doesn't help you. In Surah 55, 26 and 27 says, all that is on earth will perish, but will abide forever the face of your Lord, full of majesty, bounty, and honor.
That's contradictory. She says the same thing.
Correct. Now, what happens to Allah's shin? What happens to Allah's hands? What happens to the veil of Allah?
How is that a contradiction?
Right, is the veil of Allah created or uncreated?
Are you asking me?
Right.
Let me go learn.
Yes,
come back to you
see. Next. All right, let me go with you. Yes, of course, absolutely.
I'm sorry you found me angry.
Yassin.
Yes.
To show that I have no heart for you.
It was just
it was a furious push of mics on me.
Yassin, to show there's no hard feelings, here's a little gift for you to eat to start your learning. Feel free to come and talk to me about it again.
I'll come next week.
All right, no worries. You look at it. Come on. Right, guys. Any question on any aspect of the Christian faith before I go?
I'm a believer. I wouldn't mind a little conversation.
Yeah, do you mind having it on camera?
I don't mind.
Yeah? All right. Not to do the builder's bun this time.
So I'm a believer.
Yeah.
I'm new to the faith. Praise be to God. Glory be to God. Nice to meet you as well. You too, brother. So what it is, I can't find any scripture.